It's really an honor. For a number of years, we've spent time with Jason Upton, with Rachel, with their beautiful four children. And I want to tell you, he's one of my heroes. It's great when you have heroes who are younger than you, because it means by the time you die, they'll probably still be alive and you'll still have heroes. And he's one of my heroes. He's a poet, a philosopher. He loves God. And we're so glad to have Jason with us this weekend. I don't know where you are, Jason, but bless you.
Yeah. So, I was wondering, Rachel, would you come up with the kids? Come stand up here. This is special for me, before we start tonight. And, hey, my in-ear, listen on. So this is Lucy. So, and this is Oliver Benjamin. And this is my son Samuel. I don't know if any of you were at the call in Washington, D.C. years ago, the prayer gathering on the mall, but Samuel was literally in Rachel's belly. She was big and pregnant. Well, not big and pregnant, but you know what I'm saying? Beautifully pregnant. And this is my daughter, Emma. Who's an amazing singer, but we won't, talk about that. So, and then this is my lovely wife, Rachel. And what's special is that, I was sort of a performer coming out of Minneapolis, Minnesota, and singing. And when I met Rachel, she was really the one. She was always listening to Vineyard Worship, and she really taught me how to worship. And I remember, it was back in the day, it's kind of embarrassing, but you would sing with tracks, back in the early 90s. And Rachel did not like that. And I actually used to wear a suit and like dress up and stuff. And she kind of helped me with that too. And I remember the first moment that I was even encouraged to just be myself as a singer was she got me this for Christmas, this keyboard that I put in this worship room and she'd be listening to me in there just singing my heart out every day. And she came to hear me sing to the tracks. Afterwards, I said, "So how did it go? Was it awesome?" And she was like, "Yeah, it was pretty good. But it wasn't nearly as good as when you just sit at the piano and sing your heart out." And I told her, I said, "You just don't understand." We had this big argument, I remember, because I was like, "You just don't understand. You don't understand. Like, people aren't going to receive me just singing my heart out." And, oh, man. When you think you know it all. And it's like Rachel, to me, is, like, so special because she knows how to just be who she is, and because she knows how to be who she is, and she was loved by an incredible father, she's helped me be who I am. And, marriage is sacramental because, why? Because we make a promise in front of people to be co-creators with God, with that other person. What does that mean? It means I'm gonna partner in the ongoing creation of the other. And I just want to honor Rachel and say that she's done a lot better job partnering in the ongoing creation of me than I even have of her. But that's what we do. We're a partnership before God, saying, God, we're partnering in the ongoing creation of the other. And it's a beautiful thing to grow old with somebody like that, you know? So yeah. Happy Father's Day to me. Yeah. So grateful for you guys. Thank you. Thanks. I'm quite a difficult person to play with. I'm actually quite a fun guy to be with, but I'm a very difficult person to play with. And but tonight I want to talk about the goodness of God and the depth of kingdom worship, and what worship really, how broad, how deep, how wide it really is. You know, the Gospels don't really say a lot about singing. I wish it did, because I love singing. But it says Jesus didn't say much about singing. But he said a whole lot about following. Jesus is the greatest worship leader. If you want to know how to be a great worship leader, just watch Jesus. We were talking about it yesterday. It's like the beauty of adoration. I can't get enough of it. Of adoring God. Why? Because when I come into a place like this and I begin to adore God with songs of praise and adoration, what does it do? I don't necessarily always write those kind of songs, but why I love them for me. Maybe it's because I don't. Because it activates something in me that I need in my life. And what does that do? It doesn't lead me to pantheism. When I go out into the world, it leads me to something very good that Jesus did all the time. It's called panentheism. It's finding God in everything you see. He's constantly pointing to things. Look at those birds. Listen to those birds singing. Right? See? Worship, the worship of Jesus, it's so broad, it's beyond our ability to even comprehend. Jesus doesn't create, God doesn't create for human approval like we do. He creates for human discovery. He's fully fine with creating something and us not even seeing it for thousands of years. He doesn't pull it out of the ocean and go, look at this. And so the older I get, I love more of it. And I begin to hear worship, even in musicians that wouldn't call themselves worship leaders. I begin to listen to music and go, wow, why am I worshiping right now? Why? Because it's activating something in me. And worship is adoration. So also, we heard it last night from David. He just kind of went over it a little bit, but this whole idea of like looking at people and seeing homeless people and then seeing them transformed in the light of God's presence, all of a sudden he sees them as people having a home. What's that called? That's the kind of worship Jesus did a lot. It's called worship. Isn't it? And it's why do we praise? Why do we receive from God? Why do we sing songs like Remind Me of Your Love? Because there's a whole world crying out, Remind Me of Your Love. And as we receive, remind me of your love, sacramentally, we become what we're receiving. And we go into the world and we become the answer to people out there that don't even know that's what they're crying out for. And it's just getting broader and broader, isn't it? And so, I went to see the McClures, and our friends Johnny and Melissa Helzer, they were in Milwaukee praising God in the Milwaukee Theater, and they're so kind to us, and they wanted to hang out for the day the next day, and so we all went, and I'd just gotten back from Columbia, but I really wanted to go, and I really felt like it was important for me and Rachel to go, and really our kids, but they all had school, and then it was going to be late because it didn't start till 8, and you know the deal, right? And so the kids, some of the kids were really bummed out, and Oliver even wanted to go, and so we spent the night, and I don't know what it was. It was just that night was so special in Milwaukee, and it was like almost like every song, and it isn't always like this, but sometimes it just gets you, doesn't it? And just, I'm listening to every song, I just, tears coming down, just adoring God, declaring, hearing those words declared over me, declaring words over the city, declaring words over other people, declaring words over my family. Then declaring words over God. And I got home, and at night I had brought a friend along that really needed it. They just had twins, and he's like 25 years old, and they have twins, and they have two other little ones. So now they have four kids under four or five, you know what I mean? So he needed a worship night, you know? And so did she. So they both came, and they were so excited. And he doesn't have a lot of money, but he wanted to give me a gift in return. He's a great, just lovely man of God. And his name is Benjamin. And he looked all over Milwaukee for this Bill Fay record. Now, Bill Fay is this old guy from England that is just amazing. And I didn't know it till I started researching this guy, but he happens to be a follower of Jesus now. And this encounter with God, and it's amazing. Well, he gives me this record, and on the record it says, question, who is the sender? Question mark, you know? He says, Jason, you got to listen to this tomorrow morning. So we were going to be hanging with the Helzers for the day, so I got up early, and they were sleeping in, and so I'm up early, and I put that record on the record player, and when I did, the first song is The Geese Are Flying Westward, which is weird. Like, the geese are flying westward? Who says that? He's not singing this in America. You know what I mean? I don't know. It was what? The geese are flying westward. Geese are flying home. That's how he starts it. And immediately, the first thing that hit me was, I thought, observation. Because, you know, the great poets, you know, the great poets, just like the great fiction writers never knew the end of the story when they started. Dostoevsky didn't know the end of the story. None of the great writers knew the end of the story when they wrote their fiction work. They wrote, and they allowed it to sort of become what it became. They didn't have any, like, line points and, like, hey, let's, you know what I mean? It wasn't like a country song where we write it backwards, you know what I mean? And poets, the great poets, if you read about them and listen to poets on their teaching, they will often tell, like guys like me, like my son Samuel always says, Dad, I'd understand you more clearly if you wouldn't speak with so much metaphor. That's awesome. So I always speak with metaphor. Everything's a metaphor to me. The great poet teachers always say to their students, I want you to refrain from using metaphor. I want you just to observe. The light shining on the glass. No metaphor, just observation. See, then later on, you start to have, as you're writing, you start to have so many more tools as you're writing, right? So that touched me. It hit me. The geese are flying westward. I thought, I'm listening to this guy. He's an observation guy. He must be good. Then by the third song, and it's a record, it's a vinyl record, so I had to flip it. The third song in, he starts singing, you know, leaf and branch, flower and seed. There's a melody at the heart of it. I don't know this guy's a follower of Jesus. I'm just all of a sudden, I'm really intrigued now. I'm listening, and as I'm listening, and it's all so deep. It's all so deep. There's a melody at the heart of it. And it's all so deep. Now, tears, just like the night before, are coming down my face. It's all so deep. There's a melody at the heart of it. I thought, wow, flip, then it stops, and I have to flip the thing over, and tears are coming down my face. Put my coffee down, I walk over, and flip it over. It's the only problem with those vinyl records, you know? You have to work so hard, you know? Then, so I flip it over, I listen to the next six songs. By the time I get to song seven, I got a melody today, a revelation, a rhythm and a rhyme. And I wonder, who is the sender? I'd really like to know. This man's in his late 70s, you know? And then by track eight, he starts to cry out to the Lord for help. And then by track nine, he starts to speak the name of Jesus. And all of a sudden, I knew God was teaching me something. Something's going on, and I'm tearing. Tears are coming down my face, and I'm sitting in my chair, and I'm done with my coffee now, and I'm overwhelmed by the record, and this guy must be a believer. I'm being touched. I'm being led into something. Something beautiful. Something epic even. I don't mean to misuse that word, but something psalm-like. Right? Very broad. And I said, Lord Jesus, why is this touching me, Jesus, as much as last night touched me? What's wrong with me? I actually was asking. I was like, what's wrong with me? Why am I so weird sometimes? It's like everything. It just doesn't take anything. It's just I listen to things, and I hear God in it, and I tell people, listen to this. It's like Jesus is all over this, and they all go, what? But somehow I see it. Same with my kids. Oliver, so the Lord, I said, Lord, what is it? Why is this touching me? What is it about this that needs to be a part of the broader landscape of worship and what we're called to in our day? It's, I knew enough to know that it's in the Psalms. You get this beautiful topography, this beautiful landscape in the Psalms, don't you? And then it leads you to these giant crescendo phrases. And often these phrases, you know, we extract those wonderful phrases, but we leave out that we extract them from context. Somehow by the time Bill Fay led me to Jesus, I was so ready because he had taken me on this journey. Who's the sender? I'd really like to know. And then, Jesus. I mean, I almost felt like anybody listening to that record by the time track nine came might be saying, Jesus. Jesus is the sender. I mean, that's kind of my Christianity upbringing. I mean, who is the sender? Jesus is the sender, right? We want to so quickly say the answer. But there's something so beautiful about the question and sitting in it. It's like Good Friday without anybody getting up and going, don't worry about it, Sunday. It's on the way. It ruins Sunday. If you have no Good Friday, Sunday is just like every day. There's something about having the courage. And for those of us that are learning how to worship, to have the patience to just have to sit there in the darkness for a day and wait another day until we say, he's risen. Jesus is the answer, right? So I asked the Lord that. So the Lord reminds me that morning, Oliver hadn't been able to come the night before, so he often will jump in our bed with us when he's, you know, feeling like it, wants to come for a visit. So he jumps in our bed in between us at 5:15 in the morning, and now I'm awake, and I'm looking at him, and his eyes are open, looking back at me. He's just waiting for my eyes to open. And now it's 5:30 in the morning, and it was just on me now. The night before, I'm with the Helzers and the McClures, and I'm declaring, so it just is on me, I say, because you become what you receive.
Yes.
You see? So it's on me, and I say, Oliver, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. Oliver looks at me. He says, what does that mean, Daddy? He says to me, I said, it means when I look at you, I can't help but be overwhelmed with awe at the way God's made you. I mean, look at your hands, look at your feet, look at the way you run, look at how you jump on things, look at how you're always on top of everything, the top of the top. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. You exude so much wonder, Oliver. I'm filled with wonder just being around you. He said, oh. He said, is Mama fearfully and wonderfully made? I said, yeah. He said, are you fearfully and wonderfully made, Daddy? I said, yeah. He said, is Lucy and Emma and Samuel, are they fearfully and wonderfully made? I said, yeah, of course. I said, like when you look at Samuel, he's 10 years older than you. When you look at Samuel, don't you say that, I mean, don't you think that he's fearfully and wonderfully made? He said, no, I'd never say that. I said, what do you mean? What would you say, Oliver? He said, well, I'd just say that he's got blonde hair and blue eyes, and he's a whole lot taller than me. After the Bill Fay record, all of a sudden, what is it? He brought me back to that. What was it? Oliver doesn't have the phrase fearfully and wonderfully made. He's doing it. I don't ever say that. I just say that he's got blonde hair and blue eyes, and he's a whole lot bigger than me. He's doing fearfully and wonderfully made. He's seeing with eyes of wonder. Now, sometimes what we do is we get the fear, you're fearfully and wonderfully made, but we don't do it. The activity has been long gone. Oliver's so far behind that he's so far ahead in worship. He has not the terminology. He's got all of the worship. And it's important within our worship. The Psalms do this. They take us on these beautiful journeys, and they're not afraid for you to misunderstand or misdiagnose the situation or go, wow, what a bummer. It's like, and it's not just, hey, we're going to take you on this journey, and then we're going to pipe it up hot. Maybe that's why every theologian says, get yourself centered on the Psalms. If you want to know the whole deal, get into the Psalms. Forever, guys, get into the Psalms. Get into the Psalms. Get into the Psalms. Why? Because they're not afraid to tell the whole story, the whole journey. And then when you tell the whole journey and the whole story, when you hit the crescendo, it means something. When you've had a Good Friday, Jesus is resurrected means something. The sun coming up means something, right? Amen. So, just like, let's take this song. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. What's the next words? You remember? We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, right? That's it, right? Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. We live for you, right? We live for you because you are what? Holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my heart in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and feel me. To those holy, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your love and lead me to those around me, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will set for a second while I'm and I'll you see, listen to this. I love the life of Peter. I wish only in the scripture that there were more lives of Peter that we have, because we get the whole story. Nothing's cut out. There's this verse in the 22nd chapter of Luke, verse 31 and 32. It just says this. It says, and the Lord said to Peter, which is interesting because they're kind of having an argument. Peter was always arguing with Jesus, you know. And Jesus goes back to his original given name. He says, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, you will strengthen your brothers. This is something we don't talk a lot about in this idea of worshiping life. Is Peter's an incredible expression within Scripture of a worshiping life, of a life becoming. You want to talk about presence with Jesus, following Jesus, right? It's the beauty. I wrote this on a retreat one time. The beauty is we don't find God. This is the beauty seen in even Peter's life, but all of our lives, we don't find God. God finds us. So who do we find? Well, we find ourselves eventually, hopefully, right? And when we do, we find the one who's found us and loved us long before we could find and love ourselves. The hand of Jesus. Who do you say I am, Peter? Simon, I say you're the Son of the living God, and this is who I say you are. The beauty of the life of Jesus is that Jesus is present to places in us that we are not even yet present to ourselves. I got to go with Charles, and we went to a quiet retreat with this blind Jesuit priest named Father Gillick. It was the greatest time. Awesome. Just having him with me, it was just, oh. And he's blind. I took a bunch of worship leaders there this year to go see him. And first night, you know, because worship leaders were all so insecure and always, you know, like he said last night, and Father Gillick, so all my worship leader friends, Pat Barrett was there, you know, just tons of guys, Andrew Aaron Zeller, you know, 8 or 9 guys, and Ben Smith, and all those guys are so awesome. But we all thought it was so amazing because we're all coming from these cultures where, you know, you get on a stage and you get to speak and they're all waiting for him because I've told them all about how awesome he is, right? And he walks in the room the first night, and they're like so waiting for this guy because they've heard me tell them all about him, you know. And he walks into the room with his cane. And as he's walking into the room, it takes him like 2.5 minutes to find his chair. He's in his 70s. He's walking into the room, and it takes him about 2.5 minutes to find the chair. But it actually felt to everybody in the room like about 20 minutes because you didn't know what to do. You're like, should we help him find his chair? Should we? And so he walks into the room after they announce him in pure silence. He walks into the room and he runs into the wall. And then everybody's like, oh. And then it was so beautiful, it almost seemed on purpose, you know? And then he walks over and he hits his head on the lamp. And then he finally finds his way to the seat and he sits down. This is his opening. And he sits down and he puts the mic around and he had it right here. It's like super cool, right? Right here, it's so funny. And this was the thing that the guys would all joke about is he would get done saying 20 minutes of absolute, like, unbelievableness. It's not even a word. And he would click it off or click it on. That was it's over. It was like his drop the mic moment, you know? And so he clicks it on. And after all that time and the tension in the room, he just starts the entire retreat with this statement. Sometimes it just takes as long as it takes. Oh my God. Oh my God, you're so unbelievable. I mean, you know, you just almost start laughing out loud. It's so good. Like, I can't believe it. This is unbelievable. And then he just goes on for 20 minutes and just opens up our heart. And every time I see him, I'm just amazed because he's blind, but he sees better than anybody I know that sees. How is it possible? And he listens better too. He hears everything. One time I heard him preaching and he said, this morning I found myself laughing, listening to a goose singing. It actually so inspired me to learn. I can't always see the birds on my property, but I've thought, wow, but I can hear them all. So if I could just figure out what the birds sound like, then I'll know what birds are on my property. He's the one that inspired that in me. I can learn that. I've learned all my trees. Now I need to learn every bird that's around me. Then you can kind of learn what food they like. You see what I'm saying? Then you might see them. So here he's blind. He never gets to see him, but he hears him. He knows exactly what they sound like. Oh, I was laughing to myself today listening to a goose singing. You know, a goose sounds really wonderful. If you're a goose, he had me. He said, it doesn't sound like a robin. It doesn't sound like an oriole. And listen to this. And that's the beauty of it, he said. Because beauty is distinguished by its peculiarity. Yes. I just want you to just think about your life. The beauty of your life is the peculiarity of your life. The beauty of your sound is not that you sound like a robin or an oriole. The beauty of your sound is that your sound is distinguishable. The thing that absolutely maybe you're most embarrassed about your life may be the most amazing thing about your life. The thing that you actually would want people to be not present about in your life may be very well the thing that Jesus is present to in your life. Like Rachel saying, I don't know, it sounds better to me when you're in that worship room than when you're singing to the tracks. Oh, you just don't understand. No, actually, she totally understood. We sang it earlier. We're shaped and formed by the hand of God. We're held long before we can hold on. We're loved long before we even know how to love. We're found by God long before we can find God. And like Jonah, even when we run from God, we often will end up running right into our calling. Told this before, but my daughter Emma and I went on a Bible study one time when she was 9 years old. Took her out in a Bible study, and I wanted to just have a good time with her and have a Bible study, and I told her the story of Adam and Eve. And I'm in the middle of the story of Adam and Eve, just at the beginning, not the apple part or anything. And I'm just at the beginning, and she looks at me and she says, Daddy, isn't this a sad story? I said, what do you mean, Emma? It's not yet. I mean, God's just creating them. She said, don't you think it's sad that they never got to be kids? You mean they just had to start out as adults? I thought, dear God, who's taking who on a Bible study? Right? It wasn't until years later that I actually discovered that St. Irenaeus actually depicted Adam and Eve as infants for several reasons, not the least of which was their need to grow into being fully human rather than starting out perfect. Gregory of Nyssa actually said it this way. He was an important church father. He's famous for saying, sin actually happens when whatever we refuse to keep growing. I don't know if anybody saw the film The Walk, but Papa Rudy in that movie that's teaching this guy that has this dream to walk across the Twin Towers, remember? The only problem was he didn't know how to walk on a tightrope really yet, and then he's going to train him. And he says in the middle of that movie, he says, most wire walkers die. Philippe gets a little bit arrogant in his walking. He's going to do this very fast. He says, most wire walkers die when they think they've arrived. The greatest enemy of our lives in worship or anything is not, it's not falling, it's not failing, it's not being peculiar in a way that you think is embarrassing. The greatest enemy of our life is arrival. Thinking we've arrived, arriving at language or words that we actually don't mean. Singing songs to God that we're not actively living. Arriving is our enemy. Growth is an essential part of living. I learned this from my son. Even the universe grows. Most scientists believe that the universe will continue to expand for as long as eternity. And when God wanted to show us what he was like, he came as a baby and grew into a man. Listen to this. He learned how to listen. This is all part of worship, growth, life. He learned how to listen. He learned how to learn. He learned how to mimic. And by that, he learned how to talk and walk and obey and fail and fall and lose. I like to tell my kids, some of the older ones think it's a little cheesy, but God was 7 once, Oliver. God was 9 once, Lucy. God was 14 once, Emma. He knows exactly what it feels like to be 14. God was 16 once, Samuel. Jesus knows exactly what it feels like, every bit of it, to be 16. Jesus finds Peter because he's preaching to a crowd, or Simon, right? He's preaching to a crowd. This is Simon's whole beginning of his journey. He's preaching to a crowd. And Simon isn't catching any fish. And Jesus needs a boat to get away from the crowd so he can preach to them. And they're crushing it on him. And Simon says, go ahead, use my boat. So he goes out and preaches to the crowd. And as a thank you offering, he says, hey, why don't you try casting your fish on the other side? And they put those nets into the water. They've been fishing all night, and they couldn't catch anything. And they catch such a haul that is breaking the nets. And Simon says, Lord, Lord, get away from me. I'm unworthy. And Jesus says, essentially this, I'm not only going to not get away from you, come closer. Come be with me. Come be with me. And we're going to go on this whole journey of real active worship and transformation. And you know the story. It's too deep for tonight, but there's so many little moments, aren't there? And Peter is just like us. He's fighting God or his wife, which sometimes feels like the same thing. You know, he's fighting along the whole way. And eventually, what happens? Peter begins, after Jesus' death and resurrection, to recognize, oh, Jesus was present to places in me I wasn't even present to myself, you see. This is our whole life and journey. Even what's valuable about you, the worth-ship of your life matters to Jesus. And the beautiful thing, is that the story of many of our lives is like Peter, and the beauty is after Peter's denial, which he denies and says, this is the text here, it's amazing. There's only two coal fires in the whole Bible. It's where Jesus is denied by Peter, and also where Jesus reinstates Peter. It's like Jesus sets up the whole scene, right? And there it is, the coal fire is there, so he could smell that and be reminded of that denial. And what happens? What happens is he's walking on the seashore. It's not just coincidence, it's the beauty of the Gospels. And there, I mean, this is the best worship song ever written, if you ask me, this whole story. And there, Jesus is walking on the seashore, and he calls out to Peter. Peter is so filled with condemnation and guilt. I don't believe it's that Jesus' voice was unrecognizable because he was in resurrected form. Because John recognized his voice. Peter doesn't even recognize Jesus' voice. Jesus calls out from the seashore and says, hey, boys, because they're not catching fish again. Hey, boys. Why don't you cast your nets on the other side? Isn't that just awesome? Peter's like, who is that? John says, that's Jesus. Look at the text. He doesn't even recognize it. Do you ever get to that place in your life where you're just so full of shame and guilt and condemnation that Jesus can be calling out to you and you can't even recognize his voice? Calling out to you through your children, calling out to you through friends, calling out to you, you can't even recognize it. But John recognizes it. He says it's Jesus. And I love this. The Bible says that Peter didn't walk on the water to Jesus. Peter jumped in the water and swam to shore. I mean, that's even better. And there he is on the seashore, soaking wet, standing for Jesus, and Jesus reinstates Peter. This is the beauty of a worship song. It takes a while, doesn't it, in the Gospels? Now let's go back to the text. You see, most editors, they always put above this text, Jesus predicts Peter's denial. But there's such a better word in what Jesus says. It is kind of in predicting his denial, but the better word is Jesus predicts Peter's return. He's present to places in Peter that he's not even present to himself. Let's read it together again. And the Lord said, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith will not fail. And when you have returned to me, you will strengthen your brothers. Isn't that something? What kind of people are we? What words do we receive? When people walk away, I love that, but I prayed for you. What about your children, grandchildren? Family, friends. Half the time we get mad and frustrated if a Christian thinks differently than us. What kind of people do we become? Jesus seems steadfast. I've prayed for you. Satan has asked for you that he might sift you as wheat, but I've prayed for you that your faith will not fail. I remember seeing a Catholic priest one day, and this is a very funny joke if you're not Catholic, but I wanted to see a Catholic priest one day, which actually kind of sounds like a joke in some ways, you know what I mean? So I went to see this Catholic priest, and I was telling him that sometimes when you follow Jesus, sometimes it's just a difficult world out there, because even when you feel like you're following Jesus and growing in Jesus, people can get mad and they say really bad things to you, you know, even Christians, you know. I can't tell you how many times I've been called really bad things, you know. And he said, oh, yeah. He said, I had this man that came in. I've been with him for 42 years. I've been seeing him and doing spiritual formation. And he walked into my office, an older gentleman, and he said, Father, I won't say his name. He said, Father, my son's lost his faith. He said, Jason, it took me 15 minutes in this conversation to realize that his son had just become a Methodist. Which is so awesome. That's such an awesome story. Can't even believe he told me this story. It's amazing. His son had just become a Methodist. He said, oh, I mean, how huge is that? This Catholic priest is joking with that with me. He said, and you know what I told him, Jason? I said, he called him by name. He said, Bill, your son has not lost his faith. Your son's just lost your faith. And now he's going to find his own. It's not who Jesus is. We're not talking about different religions. We're just talking about what transpires between you and Jesus when you're actually following him. That he takes on your life and my life and he weaves this beautiful thing. That our story is very much like Peter, and this is the most beautiful worship that's ever written, is the worship Jesus is writing. With your life, with my life, with Peter's life. I was helping my daughter Lucy just write her cursive one day a few years ago, and she had one of those things out, and she wanted to write the word love. So she was writing the word love like 13, 14, 15 times. And she got many times in. I was drinking a coffee, reading a book or scripture or something, and she looked over me and she hit me and she said, Daddy, look, love's got a hole in it. I looked at it, I said, what? Love's got a hole in it. Where's it got a hole in it? I didn't see it right away. But then the more I looked, I saw that, oh. I said, love does got a hole in it, Lucy. Which, of course, as a songwriter, I thought that'd be an amazing country song. Love's got a hole in it. The more I thought about that, love's got a hole in it, the more that oh became, love's got a circle in it. I remember in my journal I wrote this. Love tells the whole story. Love fosters growth. Love lets us journey far from Eden and find our way back home again. Love is poetry more than prose. Like the great poet David White says about poetry, once poetry has said what it has to say, you can turn your face away from what was said, but when you turn your face back, it will still be waiting for you. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Jesus, the only one could ever win. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. We say, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show. Next time we sing it, we're gonna sing it like we're Peter in the boat and Jesus calls our name and everything stops for a moment and we realize the reality of the whole thing, that it's all real. Who's calling us? John, this is Jesus. Tonight, we're going to jump in the water and we're going to swim to shore. Like the chance you always wanted, we're going to swim to shore. Just stay in your seats, but in the passion of your heart, I want you to take all of that story of your life, all the peculiarity, all the things you thought, all the places you thought God left you. And I want you to hear Jesus call to you. and take you back to the beginning, when it all began and you heard his voice call you for the first time. God, we gave our lives to you because you're the firm foundation. It's not just the words we sing, it's the story of our lives. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show. Your voice and sing it again. Holy, no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show. I want you to hear this from Jesus. I've prayed for you. I have prayed for you. That's what Jesus says over us. That your faith will not fail. I have prayed for you. All of heaven is praying for you. That your faith will not fail. We're praying for you. We're praying for you. We're praying for you. I know, but don't forget, we're praying for you. We're praying for you. That your faith will not fail. Thank you, Jesus, that your love does have a hole in it. Thank you, Jesus, that you tell the whole story. And because of you, our lives, they will not be shaken. In Jesus' name.